Vin.
I'm sorry.
That's Booby.
And Jelpy and Ghosty and Chew.
Boy Sets Fire is the name of the band. After the eulogy, this is for the big
I can pronounce this song, Michael.
Kissinger.
I didn't know if you wanted this whole name out there, but there you have it.
Maybe we can delete that.
Well, I don't think it matters because everybody's names on Patreon are going to be going in the thank you video anyway. Right?
That's true. so there's multiple ways to get your song listened to, dear listener. There's Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. And there's also my favorite way, because I'm a collectivist quasi-socialist. It's $1
at the gate. You're also patient.
$1 at the gate. And then you get into what's known as an alliance. An alliance leader will reach out to you. They'll bring you into their little rabbit hole. They've got little...
Jump onto Discord with them. You'll get a link.
Yeah.
You'll get the secret link when you sign in. Yeah,
secret links and all that. A lot of cloak and dagger. It's really fun. And they take care of each other. They know each other very well. It's a whole world that has nothing to do with us. It's pretty awesome. And then...
There's a little... One of those short little video things of me going, drinking my thing.
If you're a nasty individualist capitalist, like Sora,
what the heck?
Then there's the $75 option.
No, you just don't want to wait. You're excited about the music. Right.
It's about you as the individual. Sends you straight to the Fast Pass or the Partner tier, which, by the way, is at the end of February, February 29th. That's going away, and it's going from $75 to $125. Now, if you have done three cleared $75
consecutively
songs,
where we are now, because otherwise it's going to make it too hard to
then you get grandfathered in at the $75 rate.
If you've been on it for the past 3 months and you want to stay on it for a little bit longer, then you're grandfathered in. You can stay there.
Well, grandfathered means that that's the thing forever. That's what it means.
Yes, I know that.
Okay, just want to make sure.
I'm just saying, if they stay on the $75, oh, you're saying even if they jump off and they come back a year later? No, that's not what grandfathered means. Grandfathered means you, as long as you're there, you have it.
If you leave, all right.
You can't make things too complicated. You just overcomplicate stuff.
All right. So there's that. So anyway, that's what this individual did. You
believe it or not, even capitalist
everything.
Story will just if you think that you should be able to have some sort of exception, message me on Patreon.
For time,
because if you have something to say. Maybe there's something we can do.
Topical.
But if you don't, then just don't message.
Commentary. You can hit us up at Middle America.
With Vin and Sori.
Okay. Boy Sets Fire.
I'm sure that we have another happy song here. Boy Sets Fire after the eulogy. Go.
No justice, no peace.
What's your anger? What's your fucking rage? What a death that's lost! What's your anger? What's your fucking rights? What's your right, God? 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 What's your fucking rights?
Yes, I needed a song like this. Oh my word. Okay, so that's like a probably a pretty basic, like chunky riff.
It's a new metal. It's the
yeah. I'm always gonna love it. Always, always, always.
Oh, I'm with you. That's a top ten riff, man. Yep. All time. This song was written in 2000.
Really?
Yeah. Like right before 9/11, you know, like it's so crazy. But you know, it's really interesting.
What?
We kind of did some stuff in the Bible Boogies about like the Old Testament God and why he's quote unquote so mean in the Old Testament.
Mm-hmm.
But I had a whole other thing planned out that I never touched on, which we might circle on. We had a hiatus and we're back in action this week. But the concept that a person being angry is always wrong is not true. And I think there's especially, it's very interesting, especially when I talk to some of my European friends. The concept that a person getting angry is bad universally and should always be avoided is not true.
Yeah.
There is a line in a Rage Against Machine song where he goes, anger is a gift. And, you know, I've said this a bunch of times, my goal in life is not to be a person that never has negative emotions. My goal in life is to be a person that has balanced emotions mm-hmm. and feels the way I should feel appropriate.
Yeah, positive action going along with those negative feelings or emotion is what we have. Like, that's the most... balanced and mature approach, but sometimes we
this idea that
you lash out irrationally.
the idea that you're just supposed to be calm all the time, 100% of the time, and that's a marker of high spirituality is untrue.
Mm-hmm.
It's not true.
I always thought that was the case, and then Jesus' actions like kind of confused me. I'm like, why? But it was Jesus, so. But why did you go in there and flip the money changers' tables?
Correct.
And then like when you like actually read it, and you're like, he made whips and he was hitting people with it.
Correct. Correct.
That one was a little bit hard for me to put together with my Christianity.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, he showed up 40 years later and did more than whips and mm-hmm. such. At that particular
basically what was
place.
Happening at that time was people had to travel long distances to go to make sacrifices at the temple, and they couldn't like take a lamb from their fold to carry all the way there. The lamb would have never made it because they had to come so far. So there was people that were selling the animals that were being used for sacrifices, but they would put the price up ridiculously high because they knew that they had these people over a barrel and the people had to pay for it. So they were making money off of this system that was supposed to be about, you know, finding forgiveness and finding, finding a place, making a place where people could meet with God and stuff. So it was a really, really terrible thing that they were doing. And so Jesus went in there and he shut that down.
But, you know, Mother Teresa said that the opposite of love is not hate, it's apathy. And
I can see how she would say that, that than where that, she was.
That's the major issue in our country.
Yeah.
You know, they're, you know, I was having a discussion, and these are people I love, but they're like, man, I just don't care. You know, like, so I have some people tell me, like, Vin, I just don't care about abortion. As if that means something about, yeah, I know that you don't care, because you're not the one that's getting vivisected in the womb. I know you don't care, but that's apathy.
Yeah.
You know, when people are, oh, you're so, you get so emotional about the topic. Like, I had to tell somebody, like, being emotional about a given topic is not a weakness in the argument, because there are things that we are supposed to be angry about.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you're around, we're doing horrible things all over the world right now.
I mean, if you heard a story about a parent that walked in on their child being slaughtered and chopped into pieces, and the person said, well, I mean, it just wasn't really a big deal. I didn't really care about it. You would say they were a bad parent. Like, that's an evil, evil parent. You know, so when people are so apathetic about children being chopped, you know, sucked off in pieces, like, that's a problem. That's an evil, well, evil response.
Well, then there's the other one where you separate the umbilical cord and let the kid go into cardiac arrest.
I know.
Like,
I didn't know about that one. I thought about that one this week.
Look, man, and it's not just that. It's also when you talk to, like, when you had a conversation with some people that you were close to, and you're talking about, yo, they're putting these kids in cages. And there was,
then they should come in legally.
They come in legally.
But it's kids, and they're in cages.
Yeah. But these are the same pro-life people. And it's like, and then these kids are dying in the desert. They're dropping in the desert.
These are the same people that will just, like, park their car in a handicapped parking space because they don't feel like that law is just. Oh my God.
I didn't think about that. Yeah, and so, like, this is a very confrontational song, right? But it's like, where's your anger? Where's your, you know, and you know what's funny? It's interesting. We had Albany and Corey in there, and they were talking about the echo chamber, blah, blah, blah. It's like, please, I'm in the metal community.
Mm-hmm.
99% of the time when I talk about abortion, I'm the lone voice.
Yeah.
Like, that doesn't resonate with me at all.
Right.
Like, not even a little bit.
Right.
But like, confrontational songs like this, I feel like sometimes pulls out the hypocrisy in the metal community, because on the one hand, I've noticed that when you go after their apathy for the groups of people that they honestly don't care about, they get very offended. You know what I'm saying? So it's just a universal issue with human nature, is that we're all, and you know, I think immigrants, I think the biggest exposure of my apathy for unjust treatment has probably been with the LGBT community, I think. Because of being in this community, and now I've got more, like, there was one time at the church that we were at, there was this, like, they had this radio broadcast, and there was this, was he trans? He was gay, I know that.
No,
but
he was gay.
But anyway, he was gay. And so we brought him on our show.
Yeah.
And then at the end of the show, one of the guys pulled me aside and said, You let that guy really talk for a long time.
And we had two guys. One of them was gay, and then one of them had been trans and then, like, kind of came back.
Yeah, they weren't on the same show.
No, they weren't. So I'm not sure which show
you're referencing. I'm talking specifically about the gay dude, the Star Wars guy.
Oh, okay. Yeah, yeah.
And the guy pulled me aside and said, you let that guy talk for a really long time. And I was like, well, yeah, because just like with the abortion discussion, these guys' voices are never heard in a Christian context, ever.
Yeah.
So I said, yes, I let him talk. Like, yeah, duh. Like,
know.
You know, everybody knew where we were at. Everybody knows what the Bible says about it. But I wanted this guy to be able to say what was going on and how he was feeling and all the rest of it. And no, I didn't go out, well, Leviticus, and I didn't do that. I let the guy, because I'm a big believer in giving people platforms that have voices that get silent. So whether it's a post-abortive atheist female who's completely against abortion, I'm going to give her a platform, because people on that side want to act like it's only Christians saying this.
Yeah. Right.
And so I wanted to give that guy, and I did.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, I was kind of the alpha male in the group, so, like, you know, he would come in with his little thing, and I would just redirect the conversation and let that. We were on there for 2 hours, and I let that guy have the bulk of the discussion because, you know. But here's what I'm saying. I'm bringing that up to say that even then, I was largely still apathetic to the suffering of LGBT people. Mm-hmm. Like the fact that I gave that guy 2 hours doesn't mean anything in the grand scheme of things. Like I didn't do half as 80% as much as I should have and I could have with the influence that I had with those people. Mm. I never did. And so being introduced to the metal community and being embraced by the metal community, and we were Christians, and you know, there's that kind of like feeling out process. The metal community just completely embraced us. Mm-hmm. And that was, then if you start, I got all these faces now of people that are very important to me. And now I've got, you know, Tina posts like every month or so, there's another trans person is found dead, or trans person missing, or trans person beating to the inch of their life and all this. And this shit was going on back then, and I had nothing to say about it. And so, like, I don't feel like guilty about it. I'm just talking about, like, apathy is in all of us. Is what I'm saying. Like, even if you come to another conclusion about abortion, which I honestly think is impossible if you're looking at it in the face, but even if you do, this idea, I don't care about that topic. Mm-hmm. Like, that's the type of attitude that this song is hitting on. And it's the same thing with how we treat LGBT people or how we treat, you know, immigrants. Mm-hmm. You know, I see it a lot with how black folks are treated in a majority white area. Like, mm-hmm. I see it all the time. I see that attitude all the time. It's just this dismissive, like, you know. But go ahead. It looks like what were you going to say?
Well, I just think that sometimes there's so many areas of injustice in the world around us that you don't have... You don't have enough emotion to carry all of them.
Yeah.
So then I think sometimes you have to focus on just one area and, like, you know, the other ones are there. But I don't... I think that to feel deeply about every single one just would be...
I agree with that. Soul-crushing. I agree with that.
And I don't think that that's the attitude of a lot of...
I also think it's unhealthy.
Yeah, and I don't think that's the attitude of a lot of people that are saying, I mean, I really don't care about that. Like, that's not the same thing as saying, my soul can't carry all of that pain.
Right. Because there are specific things, like, that I will not expose myself to. Like, I didn't look at the Castile video. I didn't look at the video with the, obviously I care about the Philando Castile issue, obviously. Yeah. He's the guy that got blown away by the cop who didn't get indicted, whatever. I didn't look at that. The Australian kid, and I know there's questions about it, but the initial video of him being bullied and all that, like, I didn't watch that video. And it wasn't because I was apathetic. It was because I knew what my terminus was as far as what I could handle as far as looking at horrible shit in the world.
Yeah.
There's a specific book that Jordan Peterson references all the time, and I'm a book nerd, that I specifically will not read. Mm-hmm. And it's because Peterson recounted one page of the book and I'm like, nope, I'm done. He's talking about human evil and the capacity for human evil among normal people. I'm like, nope, I've pretty much mastered that topic. I understand. Mm-hmm. Human beings are evil as hell and all these normal, like, I don't need to see, I don't need to look.
You don't need more examples.
I don't need any more examples of it. I've seen a lot, taken part in a lot. So your point is well taken. Like, I don't think it's, you know, people, that's why I said, like, I want to be a balanced person emotionally, because you could swing the other side and get yourself, you know, completely destroyed. Because I'll tell you what, if you really sat back and looked at the suffering on this planet, man,
there's so much,
and the unnecessary meanness is the thing that's really.
Yeah.
I read this book one time about, like, alien invasion. It was like this. I think it's like my fifth grade teacher was an alien or something like that. And, like, these aliens from this other planet, there was, like, a school bully. You know, just a typical school bully. And they made this giant deal, and da-da-da-da, like, what happened? And the alien was like, that guy's being mean unnecessarily. And it was like, whoa. Mm-hmm. It was like a crazy, mind-blowing moment for me as a kid reading it, because I was like, man, we're just so used to just... But it's true, like, just, if you really, really look at the depth of human suffering and the horrors that, you know, go look at, go Google the Vice Guide to Liberia and watch that. I mean, it's just, it'll overwhelm you, you know, and so you've got to, I've now become very strategic about what I'm going to expose myself to, what I'm not going to expose myself to. Mm-hmm. Even this last thing, the last thing that me and you have been dealing with, where this girl gets, 15-year-old girl gets raped 58 times on camera, and she gets put up on this porn site, and she becomes a search term because she's so popular, because all these disgusting people are looking for this barely legal whatever, and it turns out the girl was 15 years old, and her mother found her because she was a star on this platform. And, you know, we're talking to people and they're like, oh, you know, what the, hey, bad day at work, or, man, it's just like, man. And the ubiquitous nature of the internet makes it so that you can see that suffering in real time and then rewind it and play it. I don't think that that's healthy, you know. That's why I said, like, I want to be a balanced person. Yeah. I want to be a person that feels appropriately, but doesn't expose myself to too much. And then at the same time, also looking at the good side of humanity, mm-hmm. looking at the fact that Ashton Kutcher has that Men Don't Buy Girls movement where he's going up against sex trafficking. You know, looking at girls like Albany and saying, you don't have to be a Christian to say we need to fight for babies and not have them vivisected alive. And mm-hmm. looking at the LGBT community, how forgiving the LGBT community is to Christians is amazing. Mm-hmm. It is absolutely amazing how quickly these people mm-hmm. are willing to overlook generations worth of actual horrific treatment and still accept you, because yeah. we're minorities in this yep. community.
Right.
And so that's the other thing, is emotionally you also have to look at the good in life and the image of God in people. And even when you have, you know, it's like that Mr. Rogers thing where he was like, look for the helpers, you know, like, you know, these horrible mass shootings, and there's always some random stranger willing to throw his body over some woman because, you know, he's like, or some teacher in a school. That was one of the big ones that hit me. There was one time there was a mass shooting, and the teacher hit her kids in a closet, and she basically barricaded the door, and she died saving these kids mm-hmm. that didn't come from her body. Mm-hmm. So you got to look at both so that you can feel properly. You know, you can, and the implication of this song is that you ought to feel a certain way. Mm-hmm. Where is your anger? Like, you know, this is yeah. one of the craziest things.
Yeah,
people
exactly.
like, you can't tell me how to feel. Well, no, actually, feelings do have morality attached to it. Mm-hmm. Like, for example, if you can watch an ISIS video of somebody getting their head sawed off and then you start laughing, there's something wrong with you. That is an immoral feeling to have. If you're happy and it causes you joy and glee to see somebody's neck sawed off,
oh God.
Then that is an immoral emotion. Those are facts. So, you know,
I think the concept too, I mean, specifically what they're talking about here, unless I missed part of it, was people starving.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there's literally people starving.
Right.
And I don't think that we can't fix the problem of millions of starving people. We, as Vin and Sori, can't do that. Mm-hmm. We do a small part in taking part in preventing that in certain people's lives. But it takes more than just us. It takes everybody saying, I'm going to do something, even if it's something small. Mm-hmm. Like, you have to be part, of the cure of stuff. If you're not a part of the cure, then how is this ever going to get stopped? There's so many people in the world
mm-hmm.
that we have to work together, and we have to love our neighbor like we love ourselves, or like we love our own children or the people that we care about. We need to care about other people like that
mm-hmm.
and say, is my Dunkin' Donuts drink or my Cumberland Farms drink or my Starbucks drink as important to me as saving the life of some starving person? Like,
I remember I was having a conversation with Dirk one time, like a year ago. He probably doesn't even remember it. We were having an offline, off camera. Well, we were on camera, but And we were talking about the prosperity gospel, you know, this doctrine that, you know, if you're good, then God will whatever. And I was like, that's ridiculous. And I was railing against it. And then we got off at the end of it, and you were like, okay, so, because I was saying that God, if God does bless us, it's so we can bless other people. And so, like, you got off, we got off, and you were like, so should we get another kid? You know, because we, before we started the channel, we had, we've got these kids overseas that we support. And
through Compassion International,
we already had two. What are we up to now? But it, don't say it. The point is like, you have got to constantly challenge yourself. Mm. Like, you can't say, oh, we've done two, that's done enough, because mm-hmm. we're like, well, we've got more income, mm-hmm. so what's your excuse? Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah,
there really is no excuse.
I remember too, we were talking to people that were considered poor in our community.
Yeah.
Not poor in comparison to the rest of the world, but poor in our community.
Yeah.
And like, the thing that we were saying to them was like, not just getting a job to better their own lives, yeah. but getting a job so that way they could help other people.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, as your goal, like,
yeah.
how many people want to raise so that way they can help other people? Most people, it's just, I want to raise so my life can be more comfortable and I can do more things. Or, you know, it's just about your little close family. What about the rest of the world?
Yeah.
Have you ever really wanted to raise so you could...
And that's something that we have to challenge ourselves with first, you know? Like, you know, but the thing is, our community, though, that's the other inspiring thing about this community, is that this community has been the most generous community I've ever ran into in my life, mm-hmm. period. Mm-hmm. And both of us grew up around evangelicalism, yada, 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 mm-hmm. yada, yada. This is by far the most generous group of people I've mm-hmm. ever ran into, ever.
You know what's funny?
Not even close.
You know how people are always like, churches are always asking for money. I'm like, it's kind of funny when you think about it. It's like, well, churches are always asking for money because they're dealing with predominantly Christians. Site with their wallets. Yeah. Shouldn't sure. be like that.
We've been in firesides. I'm like, all right,
if they had a church of metal people, they wouldn't have to be talking
right.
about
money. You had a bunch of atheist, agnostic, trans metalheads, and we'd solve world hunger tomorrow. Because we've been in firesides. I'm like, all right, you want a shirt? And they're like, well, no, give it to so-and-so.
Oh, yeah, yeah,
like, you
yeah.
haven't even met these people. Yeah. Like, what do you do? Like, these people, like, so... But, you know, I don't know. I think it's because if you look at it, the metal community is more in tune with their actual emotions. Mm-hmm. Right? Because there's a big primer on being in tune with your emotions. And so they tend to be
yeah.
more empathetic. And especially modern Western American evangelicalism is all head knowledge. And
well, I think, too, that the topics of metal, it gets brought up. Like this song, you know. There's been bunches of songs where it's been conscious.
Yeah.
You know, it's not about just stacking up the dough for yourself and,
right.
you know, rolling in it, throwing it in the air
right.
and stuff. You know
well,
what I
no,
mean?
It's
like,
true.
It does make you, you know, if you're, it does change things depending on what you're listening to, but.
100%. No, you're right about that. Really, really, really good song. Really good song. And I think we accomplished our goal of pissing off everybody, offending yeah. everybody here, so that.
Shout out to all of you.
That makes me.
I loved this, though. I loved the sound of
I
it. I liked the vocal style. The whole thing was fun.
I know.
And it was just, it was a really, really good way of addressing the topic while keeping it in a way that makes you want to listen to the song again.
So 100%.
The topic comes up more
That's
often.
That's the strength of new metal.
It's not about, like, it could have been a really dragged out sad thing, like, about, you know, it's about starving people and stuff. But the way that they, I don't know, smart. It's a 10 for me.
I'm getting a little bit more strict in my.
I'm always gonna rate a song by how I feel about
yeah,
it.
Yeah, yeah. So I'm gonna go ahead and give that a 8.8. 8.8. Good one. Good one. If you're mad at me, well, good. At least you've got some emotion.
Yep. But which part of his speech are you mad at? That's how you need to know if it's yeah. positive emotion.
I'm sure we'll find it in the comments.
Or if you have just too much emotion.
Before they announce that they're unsubbing. Been out.
Sorry, out.
Gone.